Hello and welcome to E4M D2C Revolution. Today we have with us Shankar Prasad, the founder and chief executive officer of Plum. Hi Shankar, thank you for joining us today.
Hi Soni, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Shankar, can you give me a look into Plum's brand journey over these years and what all have you seen, the ups and downs of the brand over the years?
Sure, our journey is about 10 years old as a company and about 9 years old as a brand. And 2013 is when I started working on the idea of Plum. And back then there was no concept of D2C. The terminology did not exist. But what definitely did exist and continues to exist is the Indian consumer with her love for great product, for benefit-driven propositions, and for brands that tell the truth. And I think that's where we came in, and that's how the journey really started. We started initially very small, was bootstrapped for the first 5 years. We got the product proposition right. We got the brand proposition right. We got the products right. And throughout, we were helped by our consumers more than anything else in terms of defining what the brand and its product should be. And even today, they are fairly vocal in telling us what we should and shouldn't do. And I think the journey over the last 9 or 10 years has really been about listening to them and giving them stuff that they like, and actually building this partnership with consumers more than anything else. And that's what we love to continue to do.
And what are some of the industry trends that you noticed today, and how different are they today as compared to when you started off? You mentioned 2013, that's a long time. How have you seen the industry change?
Quite a few interesting ways. If I can call out the top three or four, and the first thing is that the openness of consumers to new brands, very, very high compared to what it was. Again, if I reflect back to a decade ago, the people who used to try our brand back then were really sort of the leading edge of consumers who were really experimentative. Today, experimentation has become mainstream. So people are willing to, even in skincare, haircare, really give a lot of width to new brands to come and try things out. The second thing that has changed over the last 10 years, and especially so over the last, I think, 3 or 4 years, ever since COVID time, is people's openness to science as a concept, as opposed to nature alone as the concept. So for example, herbal and Ayurvedic used to be very big themes about a decade, decade and a half back. In fact, it's been part of the theme for many decades now, to where people are really saying, okay, it's fine if it's herbal Ayurvedic, but tell me which are the ingredients which do what benefits you are claiming that the product offers. So people are keen to double click on what really makes the product work, rather than believing what you say in terms of this is what the product does. The third bit is about the way information is being shared and absorbed, very online heavy. In fact, it has now almost become entirely online driven. Retail becomes sort of a supporting touch point physically to what people are consuming online. So I think all content consumption, especially in the cities, has largely moved towards online, given the number of amount of time that people spend in front of their devices. So as a result, along with a lot of other content they consume, beauty content also ends up getting consumed a lot. And that really is influencing the way people think about the category in ways we did not think was possible even a few years ago. I think those are the top things that I would call out in terms of the brand, of the market's evolution over the last few years.
Today, if you see, the market has a lot of players, be it from the D2C perspective or be it from the vegan perspective, right? So what is Plum's play to, cut through or break through this D2C and vegan and butter?
The first and foremost is about being consistent. Even though we are rapid innovators as a brand, we are very consistent with our approach to what Plum is and what Plum isn't. So, for example, the thing that I spoke about being good actually resonates across every single category or every single touch point that we inhabit. So So the first thing is about being consistent in what we do, not just in terms of brand, which is what I just spoke about, but also in terms of product. The product experience with respect to a Plum is defined in three words. Again, from our end, it's called goodness that delivers. It is good, but it is not just good, but it also delivers what it is supposed to or what it promises to. Now, whether it is skincare, whether it is hair care, and within these subsegments of shampoos, masks, serums, etc., every single product of ours is designed to deliver through a combination of plant-based as well as science-driven ingredients. Now, these are some things which are, you know, I would say consistently unique to brand Plum. And last but not the least, the brand has a certain approach towards caring, which is not just very clinical, boring, but it's also about very fun and lively sort of approach to caring for oneself, while being driven by sort of science and the more sort of measurable parts of care. It's not just about getting all too serious about care. It's also about caring truly for oneself and for the world around us, and having fun doing so. And all the colors that you see around the brand are actually sort of very nicely playing together to deliver this goodness to the people that we speak about. Now, I always say that in the market like beauty, where entry barriers have always been low, and it is, if any, getting even lower, differentiation cannot be built on a single ingredient or a single platform. It has to be built through a combination of things that resonate somewhere in some corner of some consumer's mind. And that resonance is created by being consistent about product and brand. So an answer to a question like this from my end can never be saying we are different because fill in the blank. Because that because is going to get undifferentiated very quickly given the low barriers to entry. So it's really about continuing to do that which people expect us to do and people like us to do.
Also, Shankar, you did mention about people preferring new brands today, you know, one of the industry trends. Where do you think the increase, there's been an increase in disposable income amongst people. Do you think that has also played a role in people preferring to explore more and, you know, get into the newer categories? Do you think that?
No doubt that is a factor. But I think the bigger factor here is the influence of online, and therefore influencers who play a big part of influence that the online world wields. So let me explain this to you, right? In my own worldview of what we see here. If you see the average consumer journey on a device, typically it's a mobile these days, that the consumer is holding, he or she flits between shopping platforms, content platforms, social media, other apps, games, and a bunch of such things. Now, the word funnel, when it comes to marketing, has sort of lost its literal meaning of being a funnel. It's more of a journey, purchase journey of the consumer. So I see content, and I'm saying entertainment content, not just brand content, being a part of shopping platforms, which you can see on certain shopping platforms now. I can see shops being part of what influencers do online. So you can directly shop from an influencer's feed today. I can see brands collaborating with influencers and marketplaces to do lives, which sort of convert into a sale on e-commerce marketplace. I can see brands sampling with e-commerce marketplaces, and e-commerce marketplaces partnering with influencers to sample brand and so on and so forth. So basically, this has become a multi-point, I call it a ball more than, or hollow sphere more than anything else, where there's a bouncy journey towards some kind of sort of purchase and consumption from the consumer's mind. And therefore, what's actually driving this trial is really the multiple touch points that are happening online in terms of content consumption, content generation, and content consumption, which is not restricted to the content creators alone. So the entire ecosystem is now becoming driven by people wanting to know more and being told new ways to do things and new ways of learning about things. And that is what is really leading to this experimentation.
And what does Plum say a mantra to, you know, creating absolutely bang on content? And that resonates, like you mentioned, it needs to resonate with your audience, right? What is your mantra to creating that side? Sorry.
So it's a moving target, to be very frank, because, you know, consumers are evolving, platforms are evolving, devices are evolving, content creators are evolving. So it's a continuously evolving, multi-dimensionally evolving space. But to simplify things from a brand perspective, for us, I think it's very important that whatever content we put out sort of resonates with the brand's ethos of being authentic and being genuine and being good and without being too salesy and without being too, let's say, made up and without being too presumptive on things. So for us, the quality of the content takes precedence over the medium where the content is being played. The medium almost becomes secondary. The medium is basically a sort of equation solver where the consumers are inhabiting in the online world. But it's really about the quality of the content resonating with what the brand has to say, what the brand story is, and what the brand, as I said, expectations from the consumers is of what the brand is about. I mean, I am a guy who looks like this. Tomorrow I show up in extremely different looking clothes, and you're going to have trouble relating to who you saw in the first meeting, right? So you can't be randomly changing yourself just because the setting is different. You got to be true to who you are. And that, I think, is what drives us. So even if you work with influencers, where, for example, our content is very, the control is not there on what the content actually goes out, but we are very clear as to, you know, the do's and don'ts of what we request influencers to do, so that, you know, the brand, and even though this influencer talking, she's talking about the brand, it's better that we sort of stay as close as possible to the true ethos of the brand as opposed to be something different. No doubt, in online, in the world of selling, there's a lot of hyperbole that is created. There's a lot of, you know, wow, this is the greatest thing I've come across kind of language being created. But we have to be realistic and sort of apply this filter of saying, okay, you know, this is what it doesn't, this is what it doesn't. And we are fairly clear about that.
Shankar, also, I wanted to get a look at, you know, consumers are getting more and more aware, at least in the urban and tier one cities, about cosmetics and beauty care from the chemical formation perspective as well, versus the tier two and tier three cities. What sort of a response are you seeing from those consumers? Basically, a look into the localization and the strategy.
See, in terms of data today, the top 8 cities account for only about 35-38% of our D2C sales. And I guess this is true even for our marketplace sales. Consistently, we have heard numbers north of 60% for non-metro cities. So what I mean by that is cities which are non-metro are probably accounting for 60% upwards of sales of our brand. And I think it is, again, a trend that we are seeing across brand. Now, reason for that is very simple. It is a myth that purchasing power is concentrated in the larger cities. Purchasing power is actually fairly widely dispersed across, let's say, the top 30, 40, 50 cities in this country and even beyond. And now the only barrier was availability, which has been nicely solved over the last few years through e-commerce and through all the delivery partners that who have been doing a great job actually of reaching product to people in double quick time. Then the other problem to be solved was of awareness generation and you know getting the content out. And I think the role played by vernacular media and influencers in creating stuff that is not just English, but not even just Hindi, but even across languages like Punjabi, Assamese, Malayalam, you know, the list goes on in terms of content being very relatable and easily understood by people for whom, yeah, sure, they can read and write English and talk English and whatnot, but it's not the language they think in. Right? For each of us, we have a language in which we think in. And for most people in this country, English is not that language, contrary to popular belief. So vernac actually ends up playing a very big role in telling people stuff that they need to know in language that they understand. So I think that thankfully that trend started about, I would say, about five odd years ago, and it just accelerated. So now we are sort of getting into this almost language agnostic territory. And especially where video is concerned, video is very show and tell. And if it's if there's a subtitle running, which today is even automated, then you're mostly sorted in terms of overcoming language barrier. So you solved the language barrier, you solved the availability barrier, you solved the distance barrier, you solved the affordability barrier to a great extent. Therefore, there is no reason to really look at smaller towns and cities any different from your metro cities. If any, physical availability is restricted there, therefore their propensity to consume online actually goes up as opposed to going down.
Super. And moving from here to the digital aspects. Now you mentioned about the share you get from e-commerce versus the share you get from D2C, right? How do you reach out to your audience and how do you leverage the different digital channels to reach out to different consumers, the ones, say, who are coming on e-commerce versus who are directly purchasing from your...
So social media is, of course, big. Paid social media, earned social media, word of mouth social media, big part of what we do, influencers, decent part of what we do. We also respect and leverage the reach provided by the larger e-commerce platforms. We don't see them as people who are adversaries, where I have a D2C and I have xyz.com or app that is also selling to consumers in the same geography. I see us as playing different roles. As I said, in that bouncy ball that I called, what is the current version of the funnel, we occupy different parts of that ball. So there is nothing to say that if the person goes and touches that touch point, he's never going to come back to this touch point, which is my D2C. So each node in that hollow sphere has a different role to play. And our job consistently is to evaluate what role that touch point plays in the journey and continue to optimize every single time. And as I said before, it is a moving target. You can't say, okay, this is the optimum I've found and this is going to stay for the next 3 or 4 quarters. It doesn't change. It doesn't remain that way. It keeps changing because new data gets thrown at you all the time and consumers are evolving and platforms are evolving. So for us, we are able to take a quarterly view at least of saying, okay, here's where I think we are under indexed, under leveraged. And it's really about filling up those gaps wherever there are gaps rather than trying to do something too big because it's too big for a brand of our size to go on and take on head on. So for us, the strategy is always to understand where there are gaps, use a quarter time frame to fix those gaps and then move to the next gap to fill because by that time the horizon has moved forward. And thankfully, given the country that we are in and the kind of consumption tailwinds that we see, for most brands, if you just get this right, you've done most of it right. You don't have to go and create a market necessarily out there because there are enough consumers for you, which is not the case in a lot of other countries. So therefore, as I always say, to be building a brand in this country at this time is a very exciting time for anybody.
And what about your overall media mix? How are, what sort of marketing spends and, allocation of budgets are we looking at from Plum here? Especially when the festive season is going to start, is there going to be a rise we'll be seeing?
Overall, if you see, our spend is very online focused. It's almost entirely online driven, except for visibility that we do in our points of sale. And now that we have our EBOs, that visibility is also increasing. Having said that, the festive season is a slightly funny time because along with demand on products, the demand on media properties also goes up many fold. And I feel that the inflation on pricing on media properties, whether it is social media, real estate or influencer or marketplace, let's say rate card, everything spikes up in this time. Now, purely from a FOMO perspective, yeah, sure, we should be sort of there in festive season on all these platforms. But if I wear a commercial hat, it becomes difficult, to be very frank, to go out there and, get into a bidding war on every single property that exists. So I feel, very few brands would or should go, especially in tight capital scenarios, very few brands would or should go overboard in terms of over-indexing on festive season. I think what's more important is to maintain a consistency throughout the year, with very tactical spikes being taken on specific properties during this time, as opposed to just going all out. Because that all-out approach is likely to burn a big hole in people's pockets, advertisers' pockets, and I don't think that's what at least we are going to be doing. So we are going to be very measured in what we do. No doubt the demand upswing is there, and that seasonality is the given. Hopefully the monsoon, even though August has not been so great, but hopefully the monsoon will hold out and therefore sentiments will remain strong into the festive season. The next 1 month is critical from that point of view. But once that is there, then it's really a question of being thoughtful about where you deploy your ammunition.
Great. And lastly, expansion plans for Plum and anything particular that we need to be looking out for in the next couple of months, especially.
Nothing very different from our current playbook. So I think the expectation can be just more of the same, and probably hopefully better of the same, not just more of the same. So wherever we have sort of launched initiative, whether it is online in terms of content or our D2C platform, or offline, whether it is our own stores or partnerships that we have with leading retailers in the country. So each of these is in a certain version, which is by no means its final version. So some of them are in V1, some of them are in V6, but still sort of improving. So I think the improvement journey will persist, continue through the next few years. In fact, forever, improvement is forever. But definitely a lot of these are very, very young initiatives. So therefore, you will see a lot more improvements happening rather than many new things coming from our end. Even in terms of number of categories, I think we've launched a few categories in the last few quarters that are seeing great traction. And we also know which are the areas where we need to sort of focus and get things better. And that's where we are focused on over the next few quarters.
Shankar, I have one last question to ask you. What is your sort of a take on the, or your spends allocated on Instagram reels, say, for example, because they are on the growth, and you know, you can just share whatever your take is on those, on that front.
Sure. So I think reels, after TikTok rather suddenly and unceremoniously exited the country, people, but they were hooked onto the format, right? There was the reason why it sort of soared in popularity and still is popular around the world. And I think Reels was really born from that era. I think the era of short video content, more generally speaking, and short and snappy and user created rather than very scripted and over curated, that format is here to stay. At least in the foreseeable future, I don't know what will take its place. But as of now, short video, snappy video is here to stay. And therefore, you just need to take a look at our own social media in terms of the percentage of content that is now put out on Reels versus statics or carousels or any other form of content. And you will see that Reels is probably 70% of what we do on our own social media. And when it comes to influencers, I rarely see any more static posts unless and until it's some to do with some photography or something specifically. So, and also device capacity, bandwidth, network bandwidth has really improved and de-bottlenecked almost silently over the last few years. Nobody's made a big noise about it saying, hey, you know what, I got fast internet. You're all now getting used to fast internet, which is a great thing. That just makes video that much more easy. And you know, the communication task is that much more easier when you're showing something to somebody as opposed to either showing a picture of it or writing about it, which is a little difficult to consume for people. So a lot more information is entering our minds through videos than we even sort of give credit to it for.
And what sort of ROI are you seeing there? Are you getting like, because in short format video is anyway sought after, are you getting good ROI out of this?
If I talk performance marketing ROI, there it's still a mixed bag, I would say. There I'm talking more awareness generation when it comes to Reels. When we talk about ROI driven advertising, Reels is not a guarantee for higher ROI. It is about the same ROAS that we get Actually, I think it depends more on the content that you put out rather than the format of the content alone that you put out. So if it's interesting content, you can by all means get even static posts do well, extremely well. And we've seen that happen even as recently as last month. Whereas if it's boring content, your video is not going to save you any. So it's really about getting the right content hooks for people. And, I think what people don't like is being interrupted in whatever they are doing. So if, as an ad, I just try and, as an influencer, I just try and sort of force something onto somebody, it just gets repulsed with the same or more force. So I think that is the biggest takeaway that I would have on the space.
Thank you so much, Shankar. This was a great chat, great conversation. Thank you for joining us today at D2C Revolution.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here.